this event is named with this. So tonight we're screening her ballroom. Before we start, I just want to thank Cindy Bennett, whose gallery this afternoon. And Cindy, all these pieces of art are for sale, so you're welcome to look. And then Cindy also has a great book of her own art in the back. I encourage you to sign up for her mailing list or join our Facebook group, Third Diaries in Chinatown. And so we're going to have two storytellers, me and Tracy and McMillan first, before the movie begins. And we have some prizes for trivia, so try and think back on Purple Rain. Please help me welcome my good friend Tracy. Tracy and I went to college together and we danced 12 Oaks in Salt Lake City. Welcome, Tracy McMillan.
I love that we have so much shared experience. I mean, who else knows about, like, whatever, Pioneer Day? I want to hear a piece about that. Okay, I think I had something I was going to say to preface this, but damn it. Oh, I know what it was. I wrote about Michael Jackson, too. I think it was probably pretty hard not to. I'll just start. All right, all this recent business about Michael Jackson has gotten me thinking. At first, I didn't understand why I seemed to be the only person at the water cooler who couldn't get it up for the whole death of the King of Pop. I mean, it's the biggest miniseries since Roots. So how come all I could think of is, yay, maybe now someone will give Blanket an actual name. Then it hit me. I never really gave a shit about Michael Jackson. Oh, sure, he was an electrifying performer, and he could certainly cut a rug. Yeah, Michael Jackson's great. But a girl only really has room for one moist, throbbing musical crush in the heart-shaped bed of her teenage dreams. And by the time MJ came moonwalking along, my spot was already taken by Prince. And when you think about it, it's not hard to figure out why. I mean, Prince had that lyric where he said he was going to pluck the taste out of my mouth. Michael Jackson never promised me anything like that. But even more important is the fact that I'm from Minneapolis, and I came of age in the early 80s. For me, Prince didn't just live on a 12-inch by 12-inch record cover. He was around town, a living, breathing, actual human being that you could run into on the street, and he would be wearing high heels. I was 17 and a senior in high school the first time I saw Prince in the flesh. My girlfriends Anne, Chris, Kathy, and I were driving up 50th Street, sweetly tipsy after a restrained evening of underage drinking. We were stopped at a red light when suddenly this figure sweeps through the crosswalk all alone, heading toward the movie theater across the street. The very same movie theater where our friend Cindy, the 1982 Southwest High School homecoming queen, sells candy and popcorn. The one where, thanks to Cindy, we all saw Fame and Halloween multiple times, for free. And now Prince was headed there. All four of us were transfixed, not quite believing our eyes. My friend Chris, who is sitting in the front seat, says, "Are you seeing what I'm seeing?" "I'm seeing it," I say from the back seat. "It's fucking Prince, and he's in our fucking neighborhood. Not only that, but he's wearing white from head to toe, a white suit and a white full-length fur, and white ankle boots, and his hair. If you saw it, you would know why Freudians think that hair represents the id throwing off the suppression of the superego." Then, because she's way older than I am, Chris jumps out of the car and right into Prince's path. "Oh my God, oh my God, oh my God, you have to give me a kiss," she says. Prince just stands there for a long, silent beat. I guess he's considering what to do, but it gives me time to really, truly apprehend all 5 feet 2 inches of the most exquisite music and sex machine I will ever lay my eyes on. Finally, after what seems like an eternity, Prince says in a very quiet voice, "I'll shake your hand." Prince says, "Okay, okay," and breathlessly holds out her hand. We all watch as Prince shakes it. Then he says, "I gotta go." And just like that, he's gone. Into the movie theater, which actually happens to be the only art movie theater in our hometown. From that night on, I was in love with Prince. I mean, really in love. Not like when doves cry Purple Rain, Raspberry Beret type of love. No, that's for amateurs. I was in love like Lady Cab Driver, Irresistible Bitch, If I Was Your Girlfriend type of love. Like Morning, Noon, and Night, I'll Give You Head type of love. serious love. And I was very sure, extremely sure, that if Prince and I ever had the chance to sit down for a long chat, he would be in love with me too. Me too. I was so sure of this, in fact, that I stopped considering myself a Prince fan. I thought of myself more like a soulmate who just hadn't had the opportunity to meet yet. And as such, I wanted all of him or nothing. For example, one night at First Avenue, where I was a regular every Tuesday, Thursday, and when I wasn't at the gay bar, Saturday, these two guys came up to me. They said they were working on Purple Rain and asked me if I wanted to be an extra. I said no. They couldn't believe I declined, but I didn't want to be in Prince's movie. I wanted to be Prince's wife. I was willing to wait. I had reason to hope, too. One time I saw him getting out of a very flashy and terribly un-Scandinavian-looking black Jaguar near the Uptown Walgreens. I was on the bus looking out the window, and I could have sworn he was staring at me, but since he had on sunglasses, it was hard to be sure. Still, I was positive I felt the connection. My cousin Corey worked at a restaurant where Prince was a regular. He ordered the same thing every time, wild rice soup and orange juice. Corey told me he dated a few of the waitresses there, and they all said the same thing. He would take them out to his house in the suburbs, play music for them until the wee hours, but none of them reported having any actual sex, a fact which I somehow construed to mean he was saving himself for me. It was only a matter of time. Life, however, had other plans. In 1984, my uptown days ended when I moved to San Francisco with my real-life boyfriend, Kenny, the one I would eventually marry and divorce. Kenny didn't wear heels, but he was a smart and kind and a great conversationalist, and he loved me. The day Purple Rain came out, we stood for more than an hour at a theater on Van Ness in a line that stretched around the block. I thought about telling everyone that I was almost in a movie, but they wouldn't have believed me, so I kept my mouth shut. Watching the movie, I fell in love with Prince all over again. He was obviously the most epic, talented, sexy, outrageous pop musician since, well, ever. No one, not Elvis, not Mick, not Madonna, not even Michael, could hold a candle to him. They weren't self-taught guitar gods. They couldn't write songs that rivaled classical compositions in structure and complexity. They weren't producing multiple side projects, some of them starring pop girls and bustiers. That's when I knew that if a girl only gets one voice throbbing musical crush in her lifetime, I found the right one. Prince and I were soulmates. And if we were meant to someday share a heart-shaped bed, well, I was only 19. There was still plenty of time for that.